3 beta is out now, and I'm going to take some time to just go over some of the new things in it. It's a marked improvement over the prior version in terms of the friendliness of the user interface, for sure. So yeah, let's just start playing around with it. So the tracker is the same. Nothing new here. The pattern arranger is the same. A lot of this functionality is the same. It's really just the visual appeal that has been modified. The visual organization of things, where things are located and how they are interacting with each other. So first things first that you'll notice is that the toolbar has been drastically changed. It has the transport controls at the top, which were always there, but it's definitely more elegantly kind of grouped, so that it's more of a horizontal line than the thicker toolbar was, where it was to the left of the scopes and the phase monitor. So kind of nifty, quite like it. This is all the same up here mainly. Everything is similar there. These docked areas are what's kind of new. There was always a piece up here that you could edit the instruments and samples and stuff and like pick them, you know. So plus plus minus minus to choose your sample. So let's see, it's in here. Don't know if there's anything in there. Right, so that's the same. And I'm just picking different instruments from there. That's all the same. Octave keys, hotkeys are the same. So all the stuff that we're used to, just kind of reorganized in a nicer, easier to grok, kind of tucked away fashion. I quite like this new interface a lot. So yeah, so the tabs are, by default, you have layout 1, 2, like this, 3, and then you can also use hotkeys for this, 4, 5, 6. It's kind of cool. Nice little touch on the UI there. And then this MIDI monitor is brand new. This is pretty awesome. I'm just gonna go through and see some of the newer stuff. So, yeah, there's a new window tabs over here that let you switch between these things, clicking on them. Let me create a new file and open the browser to sample area. Okay, so you have auto playback on the browser here. This adjusts the volume. You can also hear it on master or the selected. I think this is the same. I'm not sure if that was changed, but like if we throw a delay line on track 4 and we choose pre-hear on selected, track 4 is selected. When we run this, you can hear the delay is affecting it, right? So that's pretty nice. Don't know if that's a new feature or not, but I like how it's implemented in this setup. This will go up a directory and then back in. So, pretty cool how that's set up. And you have 4 tabs, just as these were over here before, adjacent to the scopes in the taller toolbar. Now things are over to the right side. Not sure if they'll allow us to shift this to the left or what, but to be honest, I'm happy with where it's at. You have a preset for songs, instrument samples, and other, just like you did in the other version. It's just a little bit nicer looking. So you just double click to open stuff, right? And it does what it should. This is a new button. I don't remember this being here, but if I click it, it will bounce the song to disk, basically. Don't want to do that. Actually, let's take a look at that dialogue. Could you always do these two things? Looks familiar. So that's the song thing. Over here you have excuse me, the browser for the instrument, and you can have presets here as well. So if I drag in 2600 bass here, this is an XRNI I created with the new version. If we go, we'll take a look at that a little bit later, how it's set up. But yeah, really cool, simple drag and drop functionality. Multiple copies, you know, quite nice. Quite like that. So, and then there's obviously the one for the samples, which you've already seen in different presets that you can set up. Like, let's see. Right, so drag and drop in the same way, and the same functionality everywhere else. Not sure what the save button does down here. I guess it would save the song. Current categories, file. Current categories, file. So I guess maybe we would select something up here, and then it would save it as an XRNI or a sample out here. And as usual, right-clicking after you navigate somewhere puts it into that slot. Pretty nifty. And then there's something for themes and skins and stuff like that. So I've modified the default skin that I created for that ProMaster stuff. So the skin, theme, whatever you want to call it, that's bundled with it right now has the original, which is nice too. It's just a little bit more shady shade. So along the lines of... keeping things a little bit simpler to view, a little bit brighter and flat looking. I preferred this, and actually it's a derivation of that other theme. So yeah, those are the tabs. You can hide and show them using this functionality. This will hide and show that top bar. Switch between these two in the same way. All of these little chevron arrow key or arrow icons show and hide the various panels. As one would expect. So quite nice. So not a whole lot of disorientation really once you get to the hang of it. This part kind of threw me a little bit because normally all this shit up here was down here before. So that was probably the hardest thing to get used to. Everything else pretty easy to understand. So let's go ahead and create a new song again. Right, so let's take a look at some of these tabs. This opens and closes this thing in the same way that it did before. You have your same pattern editor stuff over here and whatnot. So all the same stuff that we were used to. Down here is the same. The toolbar has a few things that are different, and like some of the options have been put into here. So not quite sure how I feel about that yet. I was looking for that this functionality somewhere else, and I don't know if it looked like this before, but I found it eventually. It was no big deal, but quite nice that it's all set up really in this one elegant line. The mixer hasn't changed drastically. All of these things are just as I remember them, and the functionality in here, this is all the same. So, all the same there from what I could tell. This whole panel is different. I mean, it's similar, but it's different. So here's a sampler. The sampler has gotten a serious overhaul. You can have multiple samples in one instrument. So it's like a pseudo instrument, I guess now, sort of. And you can also detach it and throw it on another monitor. That's pretty cool. I just realized that that could happen. But let me just show you an example. So let's pick up, let's go up a directory. Let's go into maybe our effects directory here. And let's see. This is a collection of the Rebirth mod files and their effects that they use in the sample slots. I just collected them all and put them into some semblance of organization, quite like some of these that were in here. A lot of memories were having as going through them. So anyway, all right, let's pick this one. Okay, and so that's in one slot, and then we'll do. This one in the slot down here. So both of these are firing at once, and this isn't necessarily new. It's just a different approach to doing it. Like there was more of a instrument versus sample, and I think it's all instrument now, and you just have different sources for your sounds. But pretty awesome. What's really cool about this is the modulators and the effects. So you can have a different effects chain on each one of these samples, which is pretty awesome. I mean, like the things that you can do with this in terms of sound design and just creativity are just kind of mind-boggling. So let's create a new effect chain for this one and a new one for this one. So we have effects chain, effects 15, this sound, that sound, and then this other one on another one. And then how this works is you can literally drag and drop the DSP stuff right in here and drag it around how you want. So distortion, right, onto effects chain one is only going to affect this. One thing that I think that would be a nice feature to add in would be some mute or solo functionality over here. Somehow, maybe it's possible, but I would like, since this is kind of the part of the workflow, things that I would be using it for is definitely for drum layering and stuff like that and creative sound design. It'd be nice to have just a button that says like mute or solo along here in the same way that we would other spots, and maybe we can do that elsewhere. Maybe not. Anywho, it'd be kind of cool to have that there. So one of the nice features is you can click, and here you've got this little browser, so let's edit the effect chain for that, and then here's our distortion. The same hotkey, Alt-click, will toggle it in the same way that it does in the mixer. That's not showing in the mixer because these are in the container of that sample. Pretty fucking cool. Yeah, that's really cool. And then you can, add another thing in here. Literally just drag and drop it up there. Pretty sweet. So what's happening here is you can hear FX21 coming through as I cut out the filter there. This isn't being affected by any of these processors. Pretty amazing. Let's add a reverb to this one. And I think you can drag these freely between them as well. Yep. I don't know if you can do multiple discontinuous selection. It doesn't look like you can like span select. But that's okay. I mean, like, how hard is it to grab this and put it here and this to put it here? You know, like, no big deal. Pretty fucking cool. Another nice feature of this, in addition to having such flexible routing, is you can choose an output for where it's going to go, but also create presets. So let's create a new preset. And now, if I create a new instrument, right here, and I'll just create an effects chain, and then choose test. Actually, that's not what I expected to happen, unless I was focused on this when I created it. Yeah, that must have been it. So I expected this to go on there, so let's fix that. So save as test. Yep, it's fine. And then let's pick this one, test. That's fucking cool. Really, really cool feature, awesome. Just amazing possibilities here. Stunning feature. The other thing that's really sweet about this is everything can have its own modulators. So, and you can group them simply. So let's say we also wanted to just reassign these, so we can pick them both. You can create a discontinuous selection in here or multiples, and let's just grab a few more. Let's just grab a whole bunch of samples and drag them in here for now. I don't think I hit the target properly. There we go. So, sorry for the cacophony, but we can choose all of these and then make the assignment down here, and it's updated. That's really good. So, and then the modulators, like I was saying, you know, here you can have all these different ones. There's also a backwards compatibility thing for the XRNIs anyway. So if I grab this guy up here, I created this in the new version, so they're already been converted. But there's an option for some of the older ones, let me show you, that you can convert the envelopes. So let's see about some Beat Slaughter, Alex's work, about, okay. So now if you right click this, you can see upgrade instrument modulation. And then when we do this, it's gonna try and take the envelopes that Alex has created in his instrument and put it into effect. Also this nice little dialogue tells you what's going on. So if you click on the, volume envelope here, you can do some manual changes. It's pretty cool. Anyway, I'm getting ahead of myself, but I thought that was a really cool feature. So let's simplify this again and get rid of those others. Right. So back to where we were. Now both of these are routed into effects chain 2. We can see that here. Let's give it a volume envelope. And I'm not sure what these little doodads do. I guess that's how I pick them. Wow, that's pretty nice. I just realized that. So these are the defaults here. I quite like this new visual editor though. I like this a lot. Pretty easy to work with. Let's get a short decay. Right? Pretty awesome. Not that there's anything wrong with the other, the original, but I quite like the way that we can do this. I would like to see maybe if it's possible to drag and drop these things around, like, you know, just visually. It's okay with this. It's not horrible. But it's just, I have this giant display in front of me. It just begs to let me just tweak right here with my mouse. Just saying. So that's pretty cool. But now let's route this guy. Let's get rid of the volume envelope on that FX21. Create a new one. So now we have this short decay, or this. This layer here is going to have a different envelope, so let's go ahead and create. Super fucking cool, man. It's so much easier to use this stuff. Also, the way to have the presets for modulation is amazingly cool. Like this, I could just say, okay, this is a short attack, I guess, right? So save as short attack. And then, awesome, super cool, just so awesome. I just can't speak loudly enough about that. It's really good. The sample editor is also great. As per before, it's just kind of tucked away in this little window now. Really nifty. Let's delete that. The macros is also something that's really, really, really cool, because what you can do is map anything that's inside of your effect router, your effects groups. So let's say we want to take our duration and map it here, and we can call it like space, whatever. Now we have this mapped here. We can actually automate this in our track. So as we make a change here, it's down there. That's good. Really, that's cool. But now, to automate it, you can add in the track level DSPs, you can add the instrument macros, and they surface. So you can get outside control. It's fucking cool. So if we recorded like just a bunch of nonsensical shit. Dragging around, it's going to go into an envelope instead of actually in the track. So if I stop doing that and check my envelopes, here's space. Fucking awesome. So cool. So super cool, because it gives you a really quick way to get in there deeply for sound design, whatever you want to do, and then like zoom out and give it like hooks inside. This is way beyond. This is just awesome. I've been really hard pressed to not use this program since I've been discovering all this stuff, and I'm a diehard live addict as well. But this is cool too. Speaking of live, there is this new DSP, which is amazingly good, called the Doofer. And the Doofer lets you do effect groups. And this should look kind of familiar to live users also. And also, I guess you could say Bitwig guys as well. What happened to my... Oh, I just collapsed it. So, pretty fucking cool. This, I think they even outdid Live a little bit here, because when I say they, I mean Tactic and his team. Check this out. There's a scaling thing here as well. So like, okay, so chorus rate, right? I'd like to be able to change the colors of these if I could at some point, but even if that never happens, this is fucking amazing. Because now we can save these little doofer thingies as presets and just recall and have like the ability to drag and drop whole groups. It's a really nice workflow feature. But the scaling of this parameter, in addition to a minimum and maximum, which I can raise and set like in real time, and I think I can invert as well. Yeah, so that will reverse the functionality of it. Let me stop mapping it so we can see it better. Right, so as I go up, it goes down because I've done that mapping that way. But going all the way down and then back all the way up, undoing the map, now we have the normal travel. But the real cool thing is a scale, man. That's, instead of just straight through, you can get some pretty sweet, that's pretty fucking creatively awesome. I'm sorry, that's just, that makes me excited when I see stuff like that happening. And obviously these things can be mapped to the MIDI. So like if you have an APC 40 like I have, or a, you know, any controller, you know, like my MicroStation has a external thing that I can do, and I can just throw a, you know, a MIDI learn on there, and now I can tweak this really simply and also record it as I want. As you can see, the envelope. So pretty fucking cool, and that's really nice. One of the other neat features of this new beta is the convolver. This is really, really, really good, because it's like, from what I can tell, it's zero latency, which is amazing, because like CR2 or whatever is the only other zero latency one that I'm aware of. There might be more, like I'm no expert, but it costs like $150. The free version has latency, and you can't really, I mean, latency on an impulse response is kind of a bummer. So they have some pretty decent open air library stuff in here. The resampling works really well. This little feature set down here is like basically identical to Native Instruments Guitar Rig Reflector. So I wonder if Beat Slaughter had a hand in some of this design in terms of like how it was set up, because I know that he had that. Anyway, not to drop names, it's just the one guy that I know that does all this stuff, and he's a really good friend and awesome guy. Hi, Alex. So yeah, that's pretty cool, but it's zero latency. So like if I take, let me take this back to a NIT. Also a nice feature is if you load an IR, so here I've got this already done, kind of loaded. So let's pick nice hall preset. You can adjust dry and wet independently, but also just cycle through. Also another nice touch was the ability to reload the impulse. So if you edit it in another editor, just reload, it will reload it without having to refind it and stuff. Pretty fucking cool. I can't tell if there's latency or not here. Let me find a more appropriate test for that. There's some ambience in here, about very small. Not sure what's going on. I guess we're hearing the effect chain of the actual this guy here. So let me delete this reverb because it's really hard to hear it. Yeah, that's better. Let's go back to short. It would be a nice feature to be able to click in here and see all the files enumerate, but that's fucking instant. And the CPU is ridiculously awesome. Like, let me load a big IR, even like something silly like that Taj Mahal concept. Where is it? Wild Spaces maybe. Like, really cool. Really, really cool. Anyway, that's the convolver. You can throw it into mono processing, I guess. Also, quite nice. That's a nice new DSP module. There might be something else new in here, but I don't know what it might be. I know that macros is new. So back to the, let me delete that guy. And then this, I don't need any more, but just to show you what was going on. Right, so we have our stuff. Let's load back our test, get our reverb back. So that's how that works. The modulation, I showed you how that works, where they're independent. Pretty cool. There's some new things in here that I haven't really played with too much, like operand. I think that's just a multiplier, like a math thing. Or like a constant, maybe. I don't know. It's my guess, because it's like when you do this, you can like add, and then this will let you invert, it looks like. Is that what that is? Oh, that's unipolar or bipolar, right? Okay. But like a ton of flexibility in this, which I've not even really scratched the tip of the iceberg on, but pretty cool. I already showed you that stuff. Let's see. The plugin stuff I have a little bit of issue with, because I don't know, it's not the greatest. But before we go there, let's do the phrase editor. So We'll get to that. I'm going to put a plug-in in place. So let's pick alto, because this is important to watch. So this is just... alto with... So I've got a DSP going on this this track somehow. What's going on there? I'm on track two. Oh, I'm on the same. This is also really cool. Like, you can have a plugin and a sampler at the same time. That's amazing. I don't know if that's new or what, but let's get rid of this. Let's do this to none. Let's go down to a brand new. Alto takes a second to unload, typically. Maybe it's going to crash the program. Usually it recovers. It does this in live too. It's not just Renoise. Right. So go down to here and let's do it here. So let's pick alto again. And let's use. Right. So what I wanted to show you is that there's this pinned thing and it basically pins the VST interface here. So if you are scooching around, the idea is it will always be open. It's a cool idea. The problem is it's imperfect. So watch what happens. Alto is a resizable synth, right? So maybe it has its own code flaws or something, but when I switch tabs and come back, like, that's not okay. And if I do this, it'll pop it out, which is fine. But then to get it back, I have to, it's a little bit weird. The implementation is weird. I can also get it back that way, which is nice. But I think if I unpin now and resize, it should act okay, right? So if I do that, but this works in other hosts okay. So just wanted to point out that, like, that's an issue that I think we need to fix at some point, or should be fixed. And then I would like the ability to set this or not in a global way, so that, like, I say, okay, always pin or don't pin, you know? I don't like how this is the default and I can't override it. Also, which kind of threw me, these macros, I had to hunt for a while to figure out on the forum that these are not applicable for plugins. Maybe that's a feature that's coming, which would be fucking amazing if it was, because imagine, like, mapping like a VST however you want and then surfacing up with that instrument macro on the panel. Just super cool if that could happen. But yeah, this threw me for a while. I'm like, why isn't this working? I couldn't figure that out. So this is a work in progress, obviously. The core functionality works. It's just a little weird in the display way. So, but what I really wanted to show you is the phrase editor. This is fucking killer. So typical host comes with like an arpeggiator, right? And it's just like, you know, a DSP module you insert into a track. This lets you like use a pattern and create a phrase for their phrase arpeggiator. So one thing I couldn't figure out was how to record this with MIDI. And I don't know if I'm just being dumb or what, but like, I think this is also a work in progress. It's obviously beta, but anyway, even if this never gets fixed or changes, because, you know, I'm entering notes, I've got to record. You would think it would go in there, but you have to type it for now. Right? So what's cool about this is to note is that LPB is variable for just this phrase. You can turn the looping on or off. You can set it up so that it's transposed with what you hit, so it acts like a traditional arpeggio. So let's stop recording and change the height of this to 16. So now when I press a key, one key only. So I gotta add some note offs in here. Hold on a minute. Right. Right, so transpose is on. I'm changing the key on my keyboard. And it's adjusting for the root. Really fucking cool. Turn off loop. One time. Turn it back on. It re-triggers. I didn't even see that before. That's amazing. The preset thing. But you can also choose offset. So it's where you press the key determines where the pattern starts. Really cool. So if you start up here, it's halfway through. Down here, it's the beginning. Over here, it's the end. Pretty nifty. And then none means kind of like not key follow at all, which is sweet for drums, because then you can just like program a whole beat in here with something like a drumatic or a battery or something, and then just lay it down with one key inside of the pattern editor. Pretty fucking cool. So yeah, that's pretty nifty. Let's see what some of these are. Someone else has made these for us. Interesting. Here's some drums loaded in here. So it can be polyphonic as well. Let's choose a arpeggiator phrase editor thingy that will sound better. It's fucking nuts. And it looks like you have quite a lot of the same functionality you would have in the regular pattern editor. Super powerful. This blows the doors off of anything that I've seen before ever. It's totally, totally cool. So yeah, so that's pretty much it. There's another tab in here, if I can find it. There was a MIDI, yeah, here it is. Super helpful, really good tool to have. I wish I had this when I had my MS-2000 because I was trying to do some SysX programming and I had to use my own monitor output with MIDI aux and then into Bohm's MIDI translator and all this shit, and it was a pain in the ass. This is going to save so much time. So yeah, that's pretty much it. Renoise 3 beta is looking fucking great. I can't wait to see what's going to happen next, and I'm super, super excited about where the program's headed now. Really great work. Really, really stunning. Great stuff. Gonna buy the upgrade before it's even available, like the next thing. So good job, Tactic and Beat Slaughter and D-Blue and all of you guys. Really great. So just gonna play this out. And thanks for watching. I appreciate the attention. Hopefully this gave you a little bit more insight into the program, but also maybe some value for some of my comments in terms of how you would like to see a use case for a person who's using the program in like a focus group kind of setting. So anyway, thanks. See ya.